AMD have just launched their Ryzen Zen 3 processors. In today's video, we're gonna get straight into the numbers for you guys with those gaming benchmarks where I've tested here 1080p as well as 1440p and 4K. Now, today's focus will be on the 5900X. That's the Ryzen 9 5900X that uses 7 nanometer, comes in at a price point of $549, but we'll also throw in the 5950X results for you guys that are thinking about getting this CPU as well. In terms of the 5800X and also the 5600X, I'm still waiting on them to come in, and we will talk about the overclocking a little bit later, but going through all these 1080p numbers, 1440p, and even 4K, where we coupled this with the RTX 3090 and also the ASRock X570 Tai Chi motherboard, we can see here that the performance out of the Zen 3 CPUs is absolutely phenomenal. It's pretty much matching that of a 10900K. And so depending on the game, and you're probably gonna see this with the heaps of other games that are getting tested out there, depending on the game, they are going to trade blows. That was pretty much my overall conclusion of looking at these results. I couldn't really put my finger on which one was the gaming king. Basically, pick a title, roll the dice, and whether the 5900X or the 10900K perform better than one another is really going to depend on that title. However, going forward, I will say one thing. I do like the IPC gains on these new Zen 3 processors. What I measured here at my studio was around a raw 15% gain in IPC, looking at the Cinebench results, which is a benchmark that AMD heavily uses, and I've used that for comparing IPC in the past. And it is these exact IPC gains, which is what I personally love as a tech enthusiast. I wanna see the company striving to keep giving us better products, innovating the game, and of course, coming out with the best numbers, which is where these new Ryzen processors really shine, in my opinion, where we look at the productivity numbers, where the 5900X, depending on the benchmark that we pull up here, we're going from Adobe to V-Ray, to also Cinebench, to 7-Zip, the 5950X and the 5900X are in another league, and they do comfortably beat out the previous generation Zen 2 CPUs, which were considered the value kings of productivity. And onto some more really good news for the Ryzen processors here, is that the power consumption out of the box is very well controlled. And in fact, I do want to go and revisit this and test it with more retail BIOSes coming out on different motherboards, where I was only limited to the Tai Chi X570, where the TDP was limited out of the box. And that's what I wanted to test on, because that's all I know to go by as to what the consumer is going to be buying off the shelves. And here we can see that both these CPUs were being limited to 120 watts when we had the 110 watts on the CPU plus the 10 watts on the SoC, and Ryzen Master was showing this. And then the from the wall power consumption figures were also showing that the power consumption was very well controlled and giving out some amazing results. However, then we overclocked the CPUs, and this is the next part that we're gonna go into here. Overclocking on these CPUs was quite simply phenomenal. I was actually blown away to the point where I want to go out and buy a retail sample just to double check and make sure these overclocks are indeed 100% and that I didn't get sent the best CPU in the game, or at least on two of them, where I was getting on both these CPUs 4.7 gigahertz all core overclocks. And the results at these levels were absolutely phenomenal, and the power consumption was still very well controlled. We were using up about the same power as a 10900K, for example, when we're overclocking, but we are getting much bigger results. However, one thing that did concern me here was that the Ryzen Master reported that the safe or the temperature limit was 90 degrees, but we were going over that 90 degrees and the CPU wasn't shutting down. And one more thing that was a little bit concerning was these overclocks were done, 4.7 gigahertz all cores was done in my Queensland humid temperature of 26 degree ambient. So I'm scratching my head as to if the 7 nanometer could improve that much in the span of a year. So very, very impressive overclocks what I'm seeing so far, though I will validate these with a retail sample and then make a whole dedicated video towards Ryzen 5000 overclocking. But in the meantime, if you are an enthusiast and you do see a lot of other reviewers getting really good scores with overclocking, and it's pretty much a unanimous decision, then I would recommend going out and getting some really good cooling and a really good motherboard, and you'll be having very happy days when it comes to getting the most out of the enthusiast tech, whether it be the 5900X or the 5950X. Though speaking of overclocking, one thing that you will want to do with these CPUs is install the Ryzen Master software, especially if you want to do an auto overclock. Here's where I did lock in the auto overclock settings, and surprisingly, they did a good job of giving you a performance boost without you having to tamper really anything. And the best thing was the power consumption and also the temperatures were also very well controlled at these levels. So if you are a newcomer to the world of PCs, but you still want to get that overclocking feeling, then the Ryzen Master software is going to do a good job of enabling you to get into the world of overclocking, at least in terms of, hey, you can tell your friends you've got an overclocked CPU. And so far into this review, it has been nothing but praise for AMD's new CPUs. However, one thing we do have to take a look at and take a step back is take a look at the value for money. And here's where I made a chart representative of the Geekbench multi-core score, where I feel like that was generally overall a very good representation of the multi-core performance. I then took the current street pricing on the CPUs that are available and then the upcoming MSRPs of the Zen 3 processors and then added that into a chart. And lo and behold, we can still see that the previous generation Ryzen 5 3600 and also the 10400F, those 6-core 12-threaded CPUs, are still pulling out objectively the best value for money. And so if you want to go out and get a Ryzen 9 5900X, do keep in mind that what are you really going to be doing with this CPU? Are you going to be using it for productivity? Is it going to be saving you time? And are you going to be coupling it with a high-end GPU? If the answer is yes to either one of those or both of those, then the 5900X and also the 5950X are going to be really good purchases that will save you a lot of time. Though on the flip side of things, if you are on a strict budget and you want to get a better GPU, then it may be worth saving some money and going with a previous generation Zen 2 Ryzen CPU at cheaper prices and spending more money on a GPU. And before we move on to a conclusion, the final thing to talk about is the latency involved with these CPUs. Now, AMD has increased the amount of cores that are going into one module from 4 to 8 this time around. And in turn, that will help reduce the latencies. However, I couldn't really find any benchmark specifically to test this. And in fact, the W Prime benchmark that I was running here wasn't really, I guess, running properly for the new Zen 3 CPUs, where I actually got some pretty odd results. And also what I used to measure on previous generation Ryzens, the CCX latency measure, that just wouldn't open up because it wouldn't recognize the CPUs. So it did seem like this release is a little bit different to previous releases, where AMD did have a much tighter control of the people who are able to test these CPUs and the biases they were given. But in direct regards to latency, Zen 2 was already really good in terms of general usage. I noticed the difference between Zen Plus and especially Zen Plus over the original Zen that was released. And from the general usage I'm seeing here from the studio, taking it through a test drive in Adobe Premiere Pro, Zen 3 is the best that AMD has produced to date. So I feel like they've definitely improved the latency, though I don't have any objective tests to test that just yet. And in relation to the IMC, AMD has said that it has improved this time around with Zen 3 versus Zen 2. The only test I can tell you that I have done here to validate that claim is put in 4 8-gigabyte sticks of 4000 megahertz G-Skill CL18 memory, where it did boot, but it didn't make it to Windows on the new Zen 3 processors, both the 5900X and the 5950X. However, on the 3950X I had here, it did pretty much just crash straight away. It wouldn't even boot. So it does look like there's an improvement, and this same thing happened on the 10900K, where that managed to just make it to Windows before it crashed. Now, I know these memory sticks do work properly. I have tested them on the 10980XE I have here in quad channel, and the 4000 megahertz XMP profile does indeed work fine. Though that being said, it feels like the IMC on Zen 3 hasn't been majorly improved versus Zen 2, where I did have 3600 megahertz CL16 Corsair Dominator sticks working on all the CPUs tested in today's review. Anyways, you're probably wondering now, should I think about buying a 5900X or a 5950X? And we'll talk about the 5950X in a dedicated video on its own. The 5900X at $549, it's a really good choice if you want to get the latest and greatest. You want that single core performance. You want something that's going to be a gaming champion, but you also want something that's going to do a lot of productivity as well, whether it be video editing or whether it be rendering an animation or just sitting back in your chair and constantly looping Cinebench R20 just to say, hey, I've got an amazing CPU? If the answer is yes to any of these three questions, then the 5900X is going to serve you very well, and the overclocking headroom, as we saw here today, is absolutely phenomenal. Though do keep in mind you do not get a Wraith Prism cooler included this time, as opposed to the 3900X, which originally did have a Wraith Prism cooler included. So you do lose that little bit of value as well on top of the $50 price increase versus the $499 versus the $549, but you are getting the really amazing IPC gains as well as that extra overclocking headroom, which does look very healthy, at least from what I can see here at the studio. Anyhow, if you enjoyed today's review, then be sure to hit that like button for us. And also let us know in the comment section below what you think of the new Zen 3 processors. Are you digging them? Is it your kettle of fish? Love reading your thoughts and opinions. As always, just like this question of the day here, which comes from Elfaran Ellisul. And they ask, how about the 3300X? Wonder if my current A320M can handle it. And they're referring to our A320 video. I'll put the link up here, where we do run a variety of different CPUs on these motherboards. And yes, the 3300X will work perfectly fine on an A320 motherboard. However, you will pretty much not get overclocking on a lot of A320s out there. Do keep that in mind, though the performance out of the box for the 3300X is really good on its own, and you can overclock memory on a lot of A320s. So if you get some good memory, the 3300X and a decent GPU, you'd be having a great value for money combo to play video games on. Anyway, guys, that's a wrap from me. I hope you enjoyed this review. The testing here does take a lot of time to conduct and present the results. And there's a lot of products coming out this month. I will say that. And actually the last few months in 2020 just seems like there's a never ending amount of products that just keep coming and keep coming. So hopefully you guys appreciate the work that we do here around Tech Gear City, where if you want to purchase something and support the channel, then those links are down there below, and I'll catch you in another tech video very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.